let's talk to Executive Director of the Henry Jackson Society, Dr. Alan Mendoza. Realpolitik, said General Lord Danitz there. And it does seem that as this war continues to go on, and more countries, almost every country in the world seems to be involved in some way, facing the repercussions, be they food shortages, be they economic, be they security threats, the Baltics, Scandinavia. What can be done? Can we actually find a situation that we may be able to reverse things and push Russia back without boots being on the ground?
Well, it won't be our boots on the ground, that's for certain. We know that we're not going to be committing any military force on the ground there. But you're right to suggest, of course, that there are many other things we can do. That there remain more sanctions to impose on Russia. There remain sort of much more military equipment we can give. And in fact, the military equipment side is fascinating, because the reason that the Ukrainians are keeping the Russians at bay right now, and even in some cases pushing back, is obviously their own bravery, firstly. But their own bravery without our equipment would not get them very far. It is our high-tech, high-impact equipment that is having a huge effect on the battlefield and enabling a pushback to occur. But the reality is, we saw this morning, there was an assessment by the Ukrainians, the Russians can continue this level of engagement for another year with no problem at all. So we are looking, unfortunately, right now at a bit of a stalemate. And the only thing we can do is to slowly tighten the vise to make things move a bit further in our direction.
Recently, Finland's president, who has allegedly in the past been quite a close ally of Vladimir Putin, cancelled a meeting with Sweden's king, just as the two have sent their membership applications to NATO, something being shored up by Britain with that military alliance, while Turkey ums and ahs and haggles over trying to get something out of it themselves. Should we be concerned about temperature rising now in the Baltic Sea, in Scandinavia?
But when you say temperature rising, I mean, we're not going to see the Russians engage in offensive military actions. We've seen them already engaging in some, energy diplomacy or sanctions of their own. They obviously cut some supplies to Finland. There may be other things happening as well. The Finns are, of course, in quite an exposed position. They've got a massive long border with the Russians. It's not that they necessarily fear the Russians coming over, but having a large and aggressive neighbour next to you is not a pleasant occurrence. I think the best thing that can be done to reduce the temperature in Scandinavia right now is to hurry on with that NATO accession process. That is the thing that will guarantee the security of those countries and ensure that we actually lower the temperature rather than leaving it in a bit of a grey area, because Putin has shown that he thrives in grey zones.
And as a consequence, Turkey suddenly plays a very fascinating role in all of this, as the country in NATO currently blocking the approval of that application, but also having a responsibility over passages through the Black Sea. Can we trust President Erdogan to be on the side of the West?
Well, no, of course we can't, because President Erdogan will always play his own game when it comes to Turkey's diplomatic positions. And the reality is that the Turks have a position to maintain with the West through NATO, through alliances with European countries and the US, but also, of course, with the energy supply politics with the Russians. And it's interesting you highlight, obviously, the role of the Montreux Convention, which is indeed the treaty that guides how you transit into the Black Sea. The Turks have already shown they've allowed Russian warships through there, the Russians claiming they were going to home base. So we can't in any way, be certain the Turks will actually follow the rules of the Montreux Convention. They are the power that essentially controls that entrance through the Dardanelles, and they can do as they wish, and they will continue to do as they wish, because the Turks play their own game always.
Dr. Alan Mendoza, thank you so much for giving us your knowledge on this subject, an ever-increasing international game of chess, it seems. Joining me on the show today...